going on, folks? Barberchair here at West Colton Yard. I've actually been here for about 24 hours just in this spot pretty much behind this little baby eucalyptus. I've had a bunch of unsuccessful attempts trying to catch out of here. Haven't slept a whole lot, but anyway, right now as the sun goes down over the yard, just making some dinner. Dinner tonight is looking like some rice with some rustic Italian vegetable soup mixed into the rice. I'm also gonna throw a can of Trader Joe's salmon in there. I got a couple options to get out of here tonight, and I'm really hoping that I'm successful tonight because this is not the place that I wanna spend my spring break in. So I'll keep you guys posted. Got this yard dog here. It's got those flashing orange lights, and that just means that this train is these units are units that make up trains. And right here we've got, so the one that this yard dog is pulling up, and also the one with these red boxcars in them. They're kind of looking like promising eastbound trains. I'm gonna watch the rest of the train and see what we got. Maybe have a potential ride out.
I'm on board the Fort Worth bound train out of Colton. I just barely missed it. I went to go get food and water at the hospital nearby, and as I was leaving the hospital, I heard the radio dispatch to highball this train, so I sprinted back and just made it. I got on this grainer. Should take me to Yuma.
As the train continues east through the Mojave Desert, the scenery becomes drier and drier, and unfortunately my cell phone battery becomes drier too. The next clip is the last clip I got before my battery died. The train stopped out here in the desert next to this wind farm. Listen to the sound these things are making. I'm out here in Yuma, Arizona. I'm on top of this hill with a radio tower, and we got the railroad tracks right there. We actually have a stack. I didn't realize this. We have a intermodal double stack train pulling out now. This double stack has two NS head units. That means it's coming from the East Coast, maybe Atlanta. Wow. Anyway, this is the southern end of Yuma. And this is the northern end of Yuma. There's downtown, and the Colorado River is over there. I'm really bummed that my cell phone battery died because I only got to show you guys about a third of the ride. After the last transmission, we passed the Salton Sea, the Imperial Valley, and then just a bunch of sand dunes until Yuma. And I got to see one of the best sunsets I've ever seen across a desert. But anyway, the plan for today is just to go into downtown Yuma, see what the town has to offer, and check out the Colorado River. I'm gonna be here for another day or so because I've got a friend coming up from Mexico who's gonna come hang out, and then it'll be on to Tucson. Got this funny mural depicting Yuma as some kind of surf town. I think this is the Santa Monica Pier pictured in it. Got this US Border Patrol boat cruising by. You ride these boat waves here. Probably about the only surfing you could do here. All right, well, this is the Colorado River.
that's California, but I'm standing here in Arizona. So the river begins this way, 13,000 feet above sea level, somewhere in Colorado. It comes down, goes through the Grand Canyon, goes through Las Vegas, and then comes straight south to here, where it meets the Gila River. And then about 5 miles downstream this way is the border with Mexico. It goes through a little bit of Mexico for about 50 miles, and then winds up at the Gulf of California.
So I brought this book along with me called Cadillac Desert. That's a picture of the Hoover Dam, but this book is about the American West and its disappearing water. So it really talks about the usage of water in the West and how irrigation is such a massive part of life here, whereas on the East Coast, a farmer can actually pretty much rely on natural rainfall to grow his crops. The book also discusses how this river right here makes life in the American West what it is. Just to name a few services it provides over half of the water supply for Los Angeles, San Diego, and Phoenix. This river illuminates all those casinos in Las Vegas, and it provides irrigation for fields that grow much of America's winter crops. Right now I'm just hanging out by the river eating some crackers with some tomato on top. Alright, I went ahead and crossed the river onto the California side of the Colorado. So we're looking back at Yuma, and we've got the Yuma Territorial State Prison right there. If you guys have seen the movie 310 to Yuma, that's where Russell Crowe, or Ben Wade as he's known in the movie, would have gone to prison. He came from somewhere to the east of here, somewhere called Bisbee, and he caught the 310 train to get put in prison here in Yuma. And this is not a bad spot to go to prison. It's actually pretty scenic. I've got this hobo camp here. I don't really come across many of these. In fact, I don't even think I've come across one, but camp rules, you get wood, you get water, you clean up, and you don't poop by camp. So, you know, there's seats for sitting down, and you got a bunch of pallets over here, and it's only for train riders, as you can see here. It says no home bums. This looks like the spot too, so I'm just gonna hang out here and hopefully get an eastbound. Well, as I was chilling there with my feet kicked back at that little hangout spot, I heard over the scanner there's a report of a trespasser at milepost. Well, I'm not gonna disclose the milepost that I was at, but right when I heard that, I got the hell up and left the Vero Road property. So now I'm just here on this lawn hanging out until it gets dark. This is going to have to be a nighttime ride after that because I don't want to risk anything. I got to come back to school and graduate. So this is going to have to be a nighttime ride, and I'll capture what I can. But for my own personal safety, we're going to have to miss out on some more scenery, which really sucks, but it is what it is.
Thank you. we're stopped out here at the junction at Welton, Arizona, where trains can continue east towards Tucson or take a more northeast turn towards Phoenix. We're waiting for a train to pass and then we're gonna keep moving. I hope we make the right turn to Tucson.
Off here in Tucson. Gotta go find a way off the property. Gotta run. Going on. So this is downtown Tucson here. We've got older Spanish style architecture mixed in with these blockier buildings here. It's a very neat city. It reminds me a lot of Albuquerque with a lot more character and life to it. But anyway, I've been hanging around downtown all day and now I'm going to go catch a bus up to the foothills, do some hiking tomorrow, and hopefully find a good place to camp. All right, I'm walking up to the Sabino Canyon Recreation Area. It's up in those mountains up there. Hopefully gonna find a campsite before it gets too dark, and if it does get dark, we got a nice full, almost full moon shining down to illuminate the landscape. So I'll check in with you guys tomorrow morning. So behind me is Bear Canyon. You can look down the canyon. There's the waterfall. So you can look down the canyon and you can see buildings in downtown Tucson right there. I wanted to step off trail for a second and show you guys the size of these saguaro cacti. So here's me standing next to one. I'm about 6'1 or 6 feet tall. And you can see this thing, before it even developed its first arms, it was easily 6 or 7 feet tall. And I read that before they develop their arms, they could be 90 to 100 years old. So they're very slow growing, and they're also the largest native cactus to the United States. Look at this. Every single plant out here wants to hurt you. That's because whatever water they can make use of, they don't want anything, humans, animals, whatever, messing with it. And as you can see, I have paid the price. Jesus. Here's a much better view of Bear Canyon, looking straight down at downtown Tucson there. Man, incredible scenery here. Make it to Tucson if you can, but be careful in the yard because it's a very high security area. The whole sunset route really is a whole high security area just because of its proximity to the Mexican border. But if
you can make the trip happen, you will be rewarded. I actually want to mention something about trains. A lot of you, well, not a lot, but I get a couple people who are interested in doing this, riding trains across the US and whatnot. And it's not something you should do over spring break or on a weekend, because it's a serious crime and it can land you in jail for 30 days. So by that logic, this trip was a bad idea. And I knew that going into it, but it was a bad idea because I had to return to school in 10 days when I left. And going to jail for potentially 30 days would not allow me to do that and achieve my goals of graduating on time. So it just goes to confirm the phrase, if you can't do the time, don't do the crime. Alright, I'm up here. Must have finished going through the elevation range at which saguaro cacti can grow, because now it's just manzanita. But there's evidence of some fire here. You get this burnt thing and also these roots on this some kind of oak tree. You can see there's definitely burn scars there, so I wonder what incident that was. Seems to have recovered very well, however long ago it was. So I hiked up Bear Canyon, and this is Sabino Canyon that I'm hiking down. There's actually a road right there that a shuttle runs up and down, runs down to the bottom of the foothills. I'm actually gonna catch that pretty soon. Other than that though, the scenery is pretty much the same here in Sabino Canyon as Bear Canyon. The rock formations are a little different, and of course the name of the canyon's different. Just one canyon west of Bear Canyon. So from the trail, you can look down on the basin that Tucson sits in. And it's in the middle of the Sonoran Desert. And naturally, that basin does not have nearly enough water to support the 550,000 people that live in Tucson. So Tucson gets its water from the Colorado River, even though it's over 300 miles away. So sometime in the 1980s, the Central Arizona Project Canal was finished. This is an artificial aqueduct that runs from Lake Havasu in western Arizona across the Sonoran Desert and then ends somewhere south of Tucson. It's over 300 miles long, and without this, Central Arizona would not be what it is. However, one unique feature is that near Tucson, you have this dramatic and extreme terrain, and the canal actually bores through it and delivers water to Tucson and a little further south, and it delivers water to communities all over Arizona. So really, Arizona would not be what it is without the CAP, as it's called. The CAP is only one of many offshoots from the Colorado River that distribute water to communities across the West. There's projects in Utah, Colorado, Wyoming, maybe Nevada. So it just reinforces this is the Cadillac Desert. And life in the West just wouldn't be what it is without the Colorado and all of its artificial extension projects. Got this bird making all kinds of noise. It's for all you bird nerds out there. Well, as I'm coming off the mountain, that's gonna conclude the episode for the Cadillac Desert. My mom's got some more frequent flyer miles she's gonna use and help me get back home on an airplane. That's just not as interesting to include in a video. So anyway, thanks Mom again, and thank you guys for hanging out and watching this video. See you next time. Thank you.